Welcome back to IO. I'm Charlotte Dobray.
I'm your host, Jared Bronski. What's going on, everybody? We haven't done a double in a very long time.
No, it hasn't. It's been a minute. Feels good. Feels good to be here.
Feeling pretty prestigious right now. King and queen in the same frame. I don't know.
Guys, we're doing top 10 child stars that went totally broke today on IO.
Which, I get it. I feel like if I was a child with a lot of money, I would not think about investments or saving. I would really buy a bunch of stupid stuff.
Yeah, like, you're like a kid in a candy store, pretty much.
Like, if I had $1 million at 16, I would 100% buy a Lamborghini. Like, imagine going to high school in a Lamborghini. Everyone's like, you're an asshole. You're like, but I can afford it.
I'd do it. By the way, like this video if you enjoy our content. Subscribe if you want more of our content. And let's get into it.
Let's do it.
Starting us off at number 10, Aaron Carter. If you grew up in the early 2000s, you definitely know all about Aaron Carter. He was Justin Bieber before Justin Bieber, if you get what I'm saying. This kid at one point was a megastar, having his music played every 5 minutes on the Disney Channel and appearing on Nickelodeon on a regular basis. Every kids award show he would be performing his hit songs, such as I Want Candy, and being the younger brother of Backstreet Boy Nick Carter, well, the guy would tour with them as well. Nowadays, however, Carter is trying to make a major comeback as a rapper, face tats and all. To say he fell off would be an understatement, as he apparently owed the IRS over $2 million back in 2013, but has since been able to pay it off. Gotta love those residuals. Maybe I'll play I Want Candy on Spotify, like on repeat for you, Aaron Carter. Miss you, man. At one point, Aaron Carter was on Dancing with the Stars, but now it seems his main focus is his rap career, although it seems he's not making it onto the charts just yet. Keyword yet. I have faith in you, Aaron.
On to number 9, Lindsay Lohan. From The Parent Trap to Mean Girls, Lindsay here had quite a career in her youth and even throughout her teenage years. However, she also had quite a few highly publicized issues with the law. Aside from this, she was battling addiction with both drugs and alcohol for a little while, and although she did seek counseling at one point, it didn't appear to help all that much. Within a month of getting caught driving under the influence with narcotics in her possession, she'd be caught doing the same thing again. Her life appeared to be falling apart, and at one point she even walked out of a jewelry store with a $2,500 necklace around her neck. I'm not sure if she didn't realize it was on, if she tried to deliberately steal it, or what the deal was really, but to no surprise, she was able to pay her way out of any legal troubles. However, considering how often she got in trouble with the law and how much money she spent getting out of these situations, it's believed she was hurting financially. At one point, Lohan signed on to do a show about her life, produced by Oprah Winfrey, in which a source claimed Oprah was paying Lohan in installments out of fear she won't follow through on her end of the deal with a lump sum payment.
At number 8, Gary Coleman. Known for his youthful appearance, Coleman actually struggled to find work as an actor, with the majority of his roles portraying him as a child. Although he shot to stardom as Arnold Jackson in Different Strokes, it seems the industry wouldn't be all that kind to Coleman, who would eventually file for bankruptcy in 1999. Although he was able to maintain some steady work in the film industry, the roles he would portray wouldn't be all that significant, at least financially, and when he passed away in 2010, it's believed he didn't have all that much to his name. As per People magazine, his most valuable asset at the time of his passing was his $315,000 Utah home.
Now on to number 7, Dustin Diamond. A lot of people likely know him as Screech from Saved by the Bell, which will lead to spin-offs and Diamond playing the character for over a decade between all the shows he was on. Following his stint as Screech, Diamond will pursue a career in stand-up, which he still is performing to this day. Unfortunately, the success of Screech didn't translate so much on stage as a stand-up comedian, which led to a few cameos and films, and a self-directed adult film in 2006. In 2009, Diamond claimed the tape didn't include him, at least the parts where it was full frontal, and the man claimed he had a stunt double, if you will, performing. That same year, he divorced from his wife Jennifer Meisner and would drop a tell-all book titled Behind the Bell. But he faced a lot of backlash, specifically from other former cast members of the show, for claiming the show involved, I quote, a lot of drugs and wild parties. Diamond would admit a lot of what was said in the book was fabricated and that a ghostwriter was responsible. 2014 saw the man get into a bar fight in which he was in possession of a switchblade, and after being sentenced to 4 months in prison but serving 3, while being released on probation, he would violate the terms, leading to another arrest in 2016. As of now, his net worth is believed to be about $50,000, and he's still attempting stand-up comedy to get by.
On to number 6 now, Erin Moran. From the age of 6 years old, Moran was appearing in films and on TV, but her big break would come in 1974, when the then 13-year-old Moran would land the role of Joni Cunningham on Happy Days. In 1982, she'd get her own spin-off in which she'd star, but following its cancellation within the year, she'd return back to her Happy Days stomping grounds. And then after Happy Days, Moran would get small parts here and there, but in 1988 explained that her suffering from depression led to her lack of acting roles moving forward. In 2010, it was confirmed by Moran herself that she'd lost her California California home due to foreclosure. And in 2017, following her passing, Variety magazine claimed she had fallen on hard times in recent years. She was reportedly kicked out of her trailer park home in Indiana because of her hard partying ways.
Halfway number 5, Danny Bonaduce. Starring in the 70s sitcom The Partridge Family, Bonaduce was a child star. However, like a lot of child stars, it seems the fame and money at such a young age was simply too much to handle. Bonaduce would battle with addictions and have his fair share of run-ins with the law over the years. After his fall from grace, Bonaduce would become an on-air personality, hosting multiple radio shows while going in and out of rehab. This would help the man get his life back together as he slowly started to get back to the place he once was. However, Bonaduce was very open when it came to his past struggles. During one of his own shows, Bonaduce admitted to listeners that at one point he was homeless, living in his car behind Drummond's Chinese Theater in Hollywood. Although it wasn't the best living conditions, Bonaduce claims he'd still greet fans looking for his autograph, give him a little smile, a little signature, and a little see you next time.
Bringing us into number 4, Jamie Foxworth. Portraying Judy Winslow in Family Matters for 4 years, Foxworth would eventually be written off the show, with little explanation as to why. On the production side of things, the introduction of Steve Urkel and budget cuts to the production led to her character eventually being written off. Following the departure from the show, Foxworth would struggle to get many gigs, and would try her hand in music with her two sisters. That didn't pan out, and looking to make some extra cash, Foxworth would try her hand in adult entertainment, which was also short-lived. In 2009, she would appear on Celebrity Rehab with Dr. Drew after battling substance abuse, and would give birth to her child son that same year.
At number 3, Natasha Lyonne. Most 90s kids would recognize Lyonne from one of the many movies she starred in, including films such as Dennis the Menace, Slums of Beverly Hills, But I'm a Cheerleader, and most notably American Pie. Unfortunately though, a few run-ins with the law led to Lyonne losing a lot of what she once had. After being arrested for driving under the influence, things would go from bad to worse, as she would eventually be kicked out of her New York City apartment for missing payment on her rent and disturbing the peace. As per the New York Post, Lyonne would be homeless for a little while, but if you're a fan of Orange is the New Black, you'd likely recognize her as Nikki Nichols. Aside from that, she also created, starred, and directed in another Netflix produced series, Russian Doll, which was nominated for numerous awards and recently signed on for another season. But, you know, the whole pandemic kind of stopped that production from happening. But hey, maybe it'll pick back up soon.
Next up at number 2, Corey Haim. Although he was acting at the age of 10, Corey wouldn't become the star he was known to be until pairing up with Corey Feldman, who was one of his best friends. The duo became known as the Two Coreys and were the biggest thing in Hollywood, or close to it, at one point. The 80s is really when their careers took off, but around this time, Haim was also experimenting with drugs and alcohol. This would lead to numerous stints in rehab. We're talking like a dozen trips. Dozens. And eventually Haim would relapse, losing everything he once had. At one point, he moved back to his hometown of Toronto with his mom, and then he moved back to LA where he would be homeless for a little while. He also attempted to revive his career numerous times, including producing a show with childhood friend Corey Feldman, but unfortunately he would relapse once again. In 2010, Corey Haim would pass away due to an accidental overdose. At the time of his passing, Corey Feldman told Larry King that he was very destitute, very broke at the time of his death.
In at number 1, Amanda Bynes. After starring in All That, Bynes would go on to have her very own sketch comedy show titled The Amanda Show. This would also lead to her starring in numerous films such as She's the Man, Liar Liar, and Hairspray. However, by 2011, Bynes would start to run into some legal trouble and would take a break from the acting industry. It seems a battle with addiction as well as mental illness would take Bynes down a very dark road, in which at one point she would be photographed sleeping on a bench, and that photo would go viral. This would lead to a lengthy Twitter rant from Bynes, which included, I quote, "I was not given money for a hotel, so I've been staying with friends, and I didn't get enough sleep last night, so I fell asleep on a couch at the Beverly Center, and a paparazzi snuck in and took pictures of me, FYI. I hate my parents for still not giving me money for a hotel. What is wrong with them? My lawyer is working to have them fully removed from being my conservator because they don't deserve control over my money. They are miserable in their life, and I will fight to get control of my finances taken away from them." Okay, yeah.
Well, that was a nice light note to end on.
I mean, I don't really know. Look, she, yeah. I don't know how to speak on the situation. I never really know what's going on with Amanda Bynes, but hey, I genuinely do wish her
hey
well.
Hey man, it's like a new age of like, we gotta respect people struggling with their mental health, essentially.
100%.
You know?
Yeah.
All right, we are just gonna wrap up this video with some comments from our video. Jeffree Star fans are reporting huge issues with his new palette. Samantha Springman said he probably rushed production on these palettes, wanted his coin while he wasn't in the middle of bad drama and scandal.
Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, I don't know why people still support the guy. Again, I don't know. I've heard his makeup's good, people like it, it's high quality.
But
then,
yeah,
like,
it is pretty good.
He does trash things, so it's like, it's one or the other.
That's one of the reasons why people do support him, it's because they love his makeup. But if his makeup isn't even good quality, then what's the point?
Yeah, I mean, I might get some backlash for this, but I'm a strong supporter of, like, if he makes good product, just use the product. Like, it doesn't mean you necessarily support him as a person. I understand he's making money off of it, But I'm sure there's things that he owns that we have no idea that he'll still make money off of. Like it's
He has properties and stuff.
So you might as well do Makes Me You Happy and just get the good makeup. Alyssa J said, it is sad. The palette is full of colors I love, but I'll never support someone like Jeffrey.
Yeah, I was sad to see that palette. It was really pretty. Wouldn't you agree? Wouldn't you like, you know, some of the colors for yourself?
Wasn't it called like the Orgy palette or something?
It was called the Orgy palette.
Like what a sick
Princess of Key said, I thought Jeffrey was one of those who made sure his makeup wasn't bad quality for his customers. Yeah, well, here we are.
That was his whole thing, right? It's like top quality, like he's the best of the best.
Maybe he knew that it wasn't gonna sell out this time, so he kind of
didn't care.
Didn't really spend too much on it. All right, guys, that's it for us. Thanks for watching.
Bye.